Okay, good morning students. Today I am starting with the module 4 portions, IEEE with the 802.11 wireless LAN security. Okay, so in previous class we have discussed about the security issues at network as well as transport layer and with the usage of the various protocols IPsec using AH and ESP protocols and also the IKE protocol, Internet Key Exchange Protocol, which had two phases. Okay, in phase one, the IKE Security Association was established. In phase two, the IPsec Security Association was used, okay, for the communication purpose. Now let us see the various issues associated with the wireless LAN. Okay, so again the wireless networks present the various challenges in the area of security. Okay, then also it is relatively very easy for an attacker to sniff the packets or even to modify and inject the malicious packets into the network also. Okay, so obviously there is a necessary for the careful design and deployment of the security protocols for the wireless networks. Okay, so in the wired network, the many organizations uses the Ethernet LAN with our existing security infrastructure that all includes the authentication server. As an example for authentication server, we can use the RADIUS server, which is the remote authentication dial-in user service. Okay, which provides the functionality like authentication, authorization, and also accounting. Okay, so again, wireless LANs. We have two types of wireless LANs, that is ad hoc network and infrastructure wireless LAN. In ad hoc network, the stations or the mobile will communicate directly with each other. Whereas in the infrastructure wireless LAN, it will make use of the access point, okay, to communicate. Okay, so here we are seeing the basic diagram here with respect to the infrastructure wireless LAN, where we are seeing two network. In each network we have the access point, and the each access point is connected with the various stations. Each stations will communicate with the access point present in that particular network, and again each of the access points are communicating with each other through the wired LAN. Two wireless LANs are connected with the wired LAN. Okay, and here it is making use of the RADIUS server for the request purpose. And we have this network one as the basic service set one, network two as the basic service set two. Okay, so here that is, a station initially sends a frame to an access point, and from the access point it is delivered to the final destination. Okay, the destination can be again one more another wireless station, or it may be the station on the wired network where that particular access point is connected. Okay, destination can be the wireless station, or it can be the station present in the wired network. Okay, therefore the access point is serving as the bridge between the wireless LAN and the existing wired network. Therefore, here the challenge is to develop the protocols that seamlessly integrate the wireless LAN with the security infrastructure of the wired network. Okay, this is a challenging task. Okay, now the network of the wireless stations associated with the access point is referred to as the basic service set, as we are seeing here in the figure. This is one basic set, this is the another basic set, because in each basic set we have the access point. The stations will be communicating with the access point. Okay, the union of the basic service sets comprises an extended service set. The collection of these basic sets, we'll be calling it as the extended service set. Okay, now each station and access point in the extended service set is again uniquely identified by the MAC address. That is a 48-bit quantity. That is each basic set means it will be having a stations and the access point. Okay, each basic set is uniquely identified by the MAC address, which is a 48-bit quantity. And each access point is identified by the SSID. That is a service set ID, which is a character string of 32 characters. Okay, so a wireless station on power up, the first task is it has to discover an access point which is there within its range. Okay, and the identification of the access point by an wireless station can be done by monitoring the wireless medium. Okay, for a special kind of the frame known as beacon. This beacon frame will be periodically broadcasted by the access point. Okay, and the beacon will be containing the SSID of the broadcasting access point. Therefore, alternatively, a station may send a probe request frame, which probes for access point within its range. Okay, a station will come to know about the access point within its range once the beacon frame was identified by monitoring the wireless medium. So with corresponding to this, the station will send a probe request frame, okay, to probe for access point within its range. Therefore, access point, after receiving this probe request frame, okay, it will again reply back to the station with the frame known as probe response frame. Okay, for each probe request frame, there will be a probe response frame from the access point. Again, this probe response frame will be containing the SSID, that is the service set ID of the access point, and also the information about its capabilities and the supported data rates, etc. Capabilities in the sense, for example, how many station, okay, it can communicate with. Okay, therefore, so the station that wishes to associate with an access point sends it an associate request frame. Okay, so the access point replies with associate response frame if it accepts the request for associating with it. Okay, so associate request frame and associate response frame will be exchanged between the station and the access point. Okay, so the earliest protocol that incorporated the security in Wi-Fi was the WEP protocol. WEP stands for wired equivalent privacy protocol, where basically it was designed to provide authentication, access control, data integrity and confidentiality, but it was not a successful protocol to satisfy all these requirements. So we have the one more protocol known as Wi-Fi protected access, that is WPA, which was intended to fix the shortcomings of the WEP without requiring a new wireless network cards. Okay, so in the LAN connections, basically what we will see, we'll be knowing about the NIC card, right? Network identification card. Similarly, for the wireless, we'll be having a wireless network cards. Okay, so the WPA was intended to fix the shortcoming of the WP without requiring this wireless network cards. Then also, the disadvantage of WPA is it is again not a perfect protocol, because it is also susceptible to the attack on its cryptographic algorithms. So we have one more version known as WPA2, whereas all the deficiencies in WEP have been addressed in the IEEE 802.11i. Okay, this is implemented in WPA2. Okay, so that is if you want to trace the advantage and disadvantage of the various algorithms, the earliest versions of 802.11 uses the Navy approaches, so where the knowledge of SSID was sufficed for a station to be authenticated to the access point. Okay, again, drawback here is the attacker could easily sniff the value of the SSID from the frames. For example, beacon frame, probe response frame, which was sent from an access point to the station. Okay, that SSID can be sniffed by the attacker and he can make use for the authentication purpose. So another approach, apart from the Navy approach, another approach is to restrict the admissions to the wireless LAN by the MAC address. So access point would maintain the list of the MAC addresses of the stations permitted to join the wireless LAN. And valid MAC addresses could be obtained again by sniffing the wireless medium, okay, by an attacker. Since AP will be having the list of MAC addresses, that data can be obtained by an attacker and he can modify, okay, his network card to spoof a valid MAC addresses. Therefore, either the Navy approach or the approach to restrict the admission to the wireless LAN by the use of a MAC addresses, okay, again are not secure. Okay, so now let us see how the authentication in WEP happens. So in WEP, the station authenticates itself to the access point using a challenge response protocol. So access point generates a challenge and sends again it to the station. That is, the mutual authentication will be done by the station and the access point. The station encrypts the challenge and it will send to the access point. And the RC4 cipher, stream cipher, is used for the encryption purpose. Okay, so now to compute the key stream, okay, the key stream is a function of the 40-bit shared secret S and the initialization vector IV. As we are seeing here, the key stream is a function of the secret key S, which is shared between both, and initialization vector value. So quick key stream is performed on these two parameters, and the challenges, then XORed with the key stream to create the response. Response equals the challenge XORed with the key stream of S, initialization vector. So the response together with the initialization vector is sent by the station to the access point. And since the shared key S is common to all the station, authorized to use the wireless LAN, right? So access point can decrypt again by generating the key stream, which is the parameter S, and initialization vector is used. So again, the drawback here is the attacker would need, again, all the attacker will monitor a challenge response pair. From this, he can compute the key stream. Now, to authenticate himself to the access point, he needs to XOR the challenge from the access point with the computed key stream. Okay, that is, he has to generate the response using challenge, which is obtained from the access point with the key stream computed by the attacker. Okay, so again, the secret key, yes, can also be obtained by the attacker. That is also one of the disadvantage. Therefore, here the dictionary attack is possible. Okay, dictionary attack is possible by eavesdropping on several challenge. Okay, that is a challenge response pair between the access point and the various station. An attacker could launch a dictionary attack to obtain the shared secret value, yes. Now let us see the how the authentication will happen in 802.11. So here we are going to discuss the version 802.11i, which uses IEEE 802.1x, which is a protocol that supports the authentication at the link layer. Okay, now we are going to discuss the security at the link layer with the usage of IEEE 802.1x protocol, which is used by the 802.11i. The three entities involved in this protocol, yes, we are seeing in the diagram, right? We have the station, access point, and the authentication server. That is, the station, we are going to call it as a supplicant, which is a wireless station. Then the authenticator is an access point in our case. Then the authentication server, we are making use of the radius server. Okay, so again, here in this protocol, the different authentication mechanisms and message types are defined by the extensible authentication protocol, that is EAP, which is standardized by Internet Engineering Task Force, that is IETF. Okay, here EAP, that is Extensible Authentication Protocol, is not really an authentication protocol, but rather a framework upon which the various authentication protocols can be supported. Okay, so and the EAP protocol comprises of the request and responses. That is, one party will request for the ID of the another party, and another party will be responding its username and the email addresses. Okay, and EAP also defines the messages that may contain the challenges and the responses used in the authentication protocols. The access point will be broadcasting its security capabilities through the beacon or probe response frames. Okay, so here in the diagram, here we are seeing the access point is requesting for the identity of the station, and station is replying back to the access point through the identity response. Okay, so here all these communications will be done to the usage of the associate request frame to communicate its security capabilities to the access point by the station. Right? Similarly, an access point will broadcast its security capabilities in the beacon or the probe response frames or associate response frame. Okay, to communicate its security to the station. Okay, so the in 802.11i, the authentication takes place after the station associates with an access point. Okay, so here identity request is sent and identity response is given to the AP. Identity can be its user ID or the email addresses like that. So the generic authentication messages in IEEE 802.11i is shown in the figure. Okay. The protocol used between the station and the access point is the EAP. The protocol used between the station and the access point is the EAP protocol, that is extensible authentication protocol. Okay, between station and the access point is used, but between the access point and the authentication server, okay, the usage of the authentication protocols depends upon the specifics. Okay, because the authentication server is often the RDS server, as we are seeing here, which uses its own message types and the formats. RDS stands for the Remote Authentication Dial-in User Service. Again, it is a client-server protocol used for authentication, authorization, and accounting. That is, AAA properties are satisfied. Okay, so now again EAP, we have various authentication protocols. Again, the main methods supported by the EAP include EAP MDS, EAP TLS, EAP TTLS, and EAP PEEP. Okay, so now here once the communication is established between station and the AP will request for the server through the message RDS access request. Okay, now in the middle part we are seeing in the box, the dashed box, okay, where the authentication is taking place, okay, between the station and the authentication server through the access point, through the access point. So once the RDS access request message is obtained from the access point, the RDS server will send the RDS access challenge, okay, to the access point. Okay, that means here this challenge is indirectly sent to the station through the access point. So the station has to reply for this challenge. That is, yeah, authentication. The station has to authenticate here. This challenge is for the station, okay, to authenticate himself with the server. So the station will be authenticating himself to the RDS server through the access point. So where we are seeing here, the once the RDS access challenge is received by the server, at the access point, now the access point is asking the station to authenticate himself. So the station is sending the authentication response to the access point. Okay, so here the station is authenticating himself to the server. Okay, so it is again the one-way protocol type. Because here we are saying access point is not authenticating. Okay, access point is not authenticating. Okay, himself with the station. Only the station is replying back to authenticate himself. Okay, the station is replying back to the challenge what he has got from the server through the access point. So authenticate response message is sent from the station to the access point. So now access point will send again the radius access request with the server to communicate, and he will be sending the authentication response what he has got from the station, okay, to the server. So here where the here at this point the station is authenticating through to the server through the access point. Okay, so once again the communication is sent from an access point to the radius server, that is that is possible only when radius server again accepts the request. So once it is done, it is a success, that is the server, the station has authenticated, okay, with the server. The success message will be sent from the access point to the station telling you have authenticated with the server. Okay, so now we have the various the authentication methods which can be used by the EAP protocol. Okay, let us see one by one. Again, these are all very simple methods. EAP MDS, this is the most basic EAP authentication methods. Again, authentication server challenges to the station to transmit the MD5 hash of the user password. Okay, so here in this case, how the authentication takes place. For example, once the authentication request is received by the station, he will be asking the user to log in. So user will be providing what, the its login credentials, right? Okay, so user ID will be sent, that ID will be sent. Okay, so here another thing is the MD5 hash of the user passwords. Okay, so as soon as the user is entered, you'll be logging with the password. So the station will compute the hash value of the password using MD5 algorithm. That is, MD5 hash of the user password is computed. Okay, that is the station prompts the user to type the his or her password. He then compute the hash of the password and sends it across. Okay, so that is the one way of authenticating done by the station to the server. But again, this method is not secure. An attacker can eavesdrop on such a message exchange, and he can replay the hashed password, thus impersonating the owner of the password. Okay, the replay attack is possible here. And also, this method will not support the authentication of the access point to the station. That means only station will be authenticating himself with the access point, whereas access point is not authenticating with the station. Because why? Your access point is the intermediator, he is not the actual server, right? Okay, so station is authenticating with the access point, but how to believe it is a correct access point? He can be attacker also, right? So that is the one type of the attack which is possible here. Okay, since the station, the authentication of the station to the server is done through the access point. Okay, so here only the station will be authenticating with the access point, but there is no authentication from the access point to the station. So that's one more disadvantage of EAP MDS. Okay, the second method is EAP TLS. Again, it is based on SSL TLS protocol. It provides the mutual authentication and agreement on the master session key. While discussing SSL protocol, we know the usage of pre-master key and the master session key. The master session key was computed with the usage of pre-master, right? Which was sent from client to the responder side. Okay, so master session key was used. Again, it requires the access point as well as the user to have the digital certificates. This method requires digital certificates from both the station and the access point. Okay, that is the one more point. Then the next method is EAP TTLS. TTLS stands for tunneled TLS. It requires again certificates only at the access point end. So access point authenticates itself to the station, and both the sides construct a secure channel. Secure channel will be established between the station and the access point. Through this secure channel, the station authenticates itself to the access point. That is, there will be a mutual authentication. Station will be authenticating to the access point. Access point will be authenticating to the station. Okay. Then the station could transmit the attribute value pair, such as, for example, the with the login details, username is equal to surname Akshay and with the password what he has entered. Okay. So in EAP TTLS, the mutual authentication will take place. Next, the finally, the protected EAP with PEEP. This was proposed by the Microsoft Cisco and RSA security and is very similar to the EAP TTLS. That is, again, mutual authentication will also be there in this method. Again, the secure channel used to start a second EAP exchange, where in the second, where in the station authenticate in authenticates itself to the authentication server here. Okay, that is in the EAP TTLS, what happens? Station will be authenticating to the access point and AP authenticating itself to the station. In EAP PEEP, what happens? Okay, in the PEEP, the secure tunnel is used to start a second EAP exchange where the station authenticates itself to the authentication server. Okay, that's one more thing. Therefore, the enhanced security offered by EAP TLS, EAP TTLS and PEEP again does, however, come at a steep price in performance measured by the message and computational overheads incurred during the authentication. Okay, so now here we discussed the authentication protocols used in IEEE 802.11i. Okay, that is how the station will be authenticating with the authentication server, and again depending on the type of the EAP what it is used. Okay, authentication protocols used among the four. Fine. So now let us see the key generation. Again, it's a very simple the hierarchy is of 802.11i keys. Okay, we are seeing here. The root of the key hierarchy is the pairwise master key, PMK. Here we are seeing PMK, which is the root key of the hierarchy, and it can be obtained in two ways. The station and the authentication server may agree on the master session key, that is MSK. MSK stands for master session key, which is agreed between station and the authentication server. Okay, the authentication server communicates this to the access point, and the access point and the station will then derive the PMK from the MSK. Okay, that's the one approach. Another method is by computing a fresh PMK that is pairwise master key, for each session, okay, by using the pre-shared key, that is PSK. PSK stands for pre-shared key, okay, which is used as PMK. Okay, next, once PMK is obtained, next is the generation of the key PTK, which is a 384-bit pairwise transient key. Okay, PMK stands for pairwise master key, PTK stands for pairwise transient key, which is a 384-bit. That is, how to obtain this PTK? The 256-bit PMK is used to derive a 384-bit pairwise transient key. This one. That is, by applying a pseudo random function on the key PMK, the PTK is obtained. Okay, so the parameters used. To obtain the PTK is, it can make use, that is, the pseudo random function on PMK, okay, will be used to generate the PTK. Next, once the PTK is obtained, okay, we are in the next level, we have three types of the keys, which is TK, KCK and KEK. That is, from the 384-bit PTK, the three keys, each of 128-bit chunks are extracted. Okay, TK is of 128-bit, KCK is of 128-bit, KEK is of 128-bit. TK stands for temporal key, KCK stands for key confirmation key, KEK stands for key encryption key. Okay, so the usage of these keys are, TK, temporal key, is used both for encryption and integrity protection of the data between the station and the access point. Then KCK is used for integrity protection, which is supported by the MAC, which was computed as a function of the message and the KCK. The MAC function will make use of the message and this KCK key. Okay, so using the MAC, the integrity check will be done. Then KEK, that is the key encryption key. Again, it is used to encrypt the message containing the group key. Okay, all these three, each is of 128-bit, which is obtained from PTK, that is pairwise transient key, which is of 384-bit. Okay, now let us see how the four-way handshake protocol will generate these keys. Okay, so again, it's a very simple protocol, four-way handshake protocol. Here, okay, we are seeing the diagram with respect to four-way handshake in 802.11i. So the main task of the four-way handshake protocol is to derive the PTK, that is pairwise transient key, from the pairwise master key. Then to verify the cipher suits communicated in the beacon and associate request frame. Okay, we know that beacon is a frame sent by the access point. Okay, then associate request frame is the frame sent by the station to associate with the access point. So the task of the four-way handshake protocol is to verify the cipher suits which are communicated in the beacon and associate request frame. See, FuzzSuite is nothing but the what are the types of the cryptographic algorithm used and the type of the keys, okay, etc. will be mentioned in this. Next, one more task of the four-way handshake protocol is communicate the group keys from the access point to the station. Okay, so here we have this is called as a four-way handshake protocol because there are totally four messages, okay, communicated between station and the access point. So in the message one, the access point will send a nonce. Always we know the usage of a nonce is a challenge value, which is a random value, okay, which is sent, okay, to authenticate with him. Okay, the AP first sends a nonce NA to the station telling, okay, station to authenticate himself to the AP. And also one more thing is it helps to prevent the replay attack. Okay, then in the message 2, we are seeing the station is sending its nonce NS, then the super suit and the MIC. Okay, that is here the station chooses a nonce NS and it will compute the PTK key, pairwise transient key, which is of 384 bit, will be computed by using the function PTK equals pseudo random function of the PMK, then the nonces from the access point NA and the nonce from the station NS, then the MAC values, MAC from the access point, MAC values from the server, that is station side. Okay, these parameters are used to calculate the PTK. So the pseudo random function is applied on all these parameters to compute the PTK value. The usage of a nonce is again to prevent the replay attack. So once the PTK is computed, from this PTK, the three keys, temporal key, then KCK, then KEK, each of 128 bits are extracted, okay, from the PTK. Then the station sends the nonce, the cipher suit, okay, and the KCK value to compute the MIC. MIC stands for message integrity check. Message integrity check will be computed with the usage of the KCK key. Okay, that is through the message 2. Then in the message 3, after receiving the message 2 from the station, okay, the receiver, that is the access point, will compute at his side also the PTK value. The primary transient key, which is of 384 bit, is computed at the access point also. And from the PTK, it will derive the three keys, TK, KCK and KEK. And the access point will verify the integrity and the source of the message to, okay, using the key KCK what it has computed. At the access point, the three keys are also generated through the usage of the PTK. Now using the KCK value, it will check for the integrity and the source of the message to, from whom it has got. Okay, integrity check will be done. Then the access point will reply to the station through the message 3. Okay, that is, again, it will be sending the super suit and the MIC, that is message integrity check. To compute the message integrity check, it will be telling to use the KCK value again. Okay, and also it is containing the group transient key JTK, group transient key, in short it is GTK, which is used by the access point and all the station to integrity protect all multicast and broadcast messages. Okay, it is called as the group transient key. Okay, that will be shared with the station with whom it is communicating. So in the message 3, the GTK, cipher suite and the MIC. Okay, which where all these values are encrypted using the KEK key, which was generated at the AP. That's access point will be used for the encryption purpose, and that will be sent in the message 3 to the station. So finally, in the message 4, okay, an acknowledgement will be sent from the station to the access point. That is, it has received the previous message without error. Okay, that is, station will be acknowledging the access point, telling I have received the previous message without any error. And also, that is, it is a signal to the access point that henceforth all the messages will be integrity protected and encrypted with the TK. Okay, temporal key will be used for the integrity check and for the encryption purpose. So these messages will be agreed between the station and the access point, that is through the message 4. So we are seeing the station will be sending OK to the AP along with the message integrity check, which tells the key TK to be used for integrity check and encryption purpose. Okay, encryption and decryption purpose at both the sides. Okay, so this is about the four-way handshake protocol, that where we saw the each station and the AP will be generating the PTK value, that is primary transient key, which is of 384 bit. From that, the three keys TK, KCK and KEK will be generated. Okay, and for message integrity check, okay, both will be telling to make use of the KCK key. Okay, and finally, in the message 3, the key KEK is used to encrypt the GTK, cipher suite and the MIC, and it will be sent to the station. And in the message 4, there is a agreement between station and the access point to make use of the key TK, okay, to do the encryption. Okay, that is, TK again is present at the station also. It also, station also computed TK, even AP also have computed TK, right, in the message 2 and 3. So that TK will be used for the encryption purpose and integrity check. So this is about the usage of the 802.11i, and we saw the various authentication protocols used. Okay.